And I think we've had an old and exhausting infrastructure model that's run its course over the last 30 years, and you really got to get a lot more private sector involvement in infrastructure. I think the issue is that how do you do that, and how do you do that quickly? Because the states and municipalities probably don't have the expertise to structure bankable projects. So you've got to replace the old model, the top-down model, with a new model.
Okay, so the Dems, which have historically said they want infrastructure, you hear Chuck Schumer say, we need $1 trillion. It's got to all come from the federal government. You hear the pushback saying, we don't want to privatize our roads, our toll, you know, toll roads and the like. And other congresspeople and senators saying, you know what, the states actually can't afford it right now.
No, it's interesting. I was listening to Senator Barrasso earlier, and I think there's a conversation that these guys haven't really started to have yet. So when you talk about a bipartisan infrastructure initiative, you know, we think Democrats, Republicans, but you're really talking about, and what you're talking about this morning with Bezos, et cetera, I mean, you're really talking about the technology people taking the lead in infrastructure and transforming infrastructure. You're talking about finance, engineering, talking about the workers who need better jobs, middle-class jobs, et cetera. So you've got a lot that you can bring together in a bipartisan way.
Are there immediate projects that you have just like in a list in your head in terms of when you look at the country that would not only be profitable to the private sector, but would actually be meaningful in terms of creating not just temporary jobs in terms of the work to create it, but long term, everything that gets built out around it?
It's unbelievable, Andrew.
Give us a list. Give us a little bit of optimism here.
I can give you 20, 30, 40 projects. Dallas to Houston high-speed rail project.
Okay.
Fantastic project. There's a fantastic new technology, natural gas exporting technology. All you have to do is dredge port in Mississippi, Gulfport. They've been trying to do that for 20 years. That'll create $20 billion in new investment. New export markets around the world.
Okay.
Forget about profit. What about things that are falling apart? There was a report released yesterday that showed more than 54,000 bridges that are about to fall apart. If you stretch them end to end, you would go all the way from New York almost to Miami. That's
a phenomenal example. So last year, Pennsylvania did a bridge PPP, replaced half of their bridges. They're going to do another RFP. You could do that for the whole country. And they brought in new technology, new ways of thinking about this, not just new financing mechanisms, but metal bridges, which take half the time to erect as cement bridges.
And is $1 trillion the number to hit in your mind?
I think $1 trillion, as you know, it's a symbol, right? It's a starting symbol. But, you know, we are probably, if you hit $1 trillion, you'd get everybody going, you'd transform the industry. And, you know, this other issue that we talk about all the time, moving from 10 years to 2 years in terms of the approval part of the process, unbelievably important. You're not going to do $1 trillion unless you address that issue.
How do you address this, which is, again, the pushback from Democrats, all of whom say they want infrastructure, and then, of course, you know, get down into the nuance and say maybe they don't want it, or at least they don't want it this way.
Right.
Is there's a worry that when the private sector gets involved, invariably the private sector is going to look at the projects that are most profitable in areas where there might be either be people who are more affluent, and that areas that are in perhaps the most dire straits in the most desperate need for infrastructure won't get it. Do you think that's a fair argument or not?
That's a great argument. That's actually true. I do infrastructure projects around the world. And so you've got to do probably two different things, you know, to create this actual conversation in terms of a bipartisan initiative. One of them is the government needs to be strong enough to enforce the agreements so you get the kind of performance that the private sector says they're going to give for 30 or 40 years, right? So you got to be more capable. But it may make sense to have a conversation about a national infrastructure bank, because the Canadians just launched, the last OECD country except us to launch a national infrastructure bank. And the focus is on exactly those issues, getting projects up and running in rural areas, water projects, all of that tends to get ignored by the private sector.
And then the other question I was going to ask is, you know, invariably you have these states that don't have the expertise to actually make these kind of investments. These are massive.
Right.
Big investments. And so what do? They hire the consultants. And then invariably something happens 5 or 10 years from now, and they say the consultants sold them down the river because there was this sort of the agency problem, the little man who didn't have the same skin in the game. How do you change that dynamic?
That's what's going on in the UK right now, right? PFI is under a huge amount of pressure after 20 years for that very reason. I think one of the things you've got to start to look at is what kind of projects we need and how you get the private sector and the public sector actually working together. And it's not just PPPs. There's seven different ways,
being
public-private partnerships.
Oh, I apologize. Okay.
No, no, no. But, you know, privatization, outright privatization, acquiring assets for 20 or 30 years to use, et cetera. There's a lot of different ways to do this.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.